there. Hi, everyone. Thanks for tuning in tonight. Tonight is our last talk for our endometriosis speaker series. And we're doing the speaker series through March for Endometriosis Awareness Month. So thanks for tuning in and listening to this chat this evening. I am here with a registered massage therapist, Anna Skura. And Anna is our resident massage therapist here at the clinic. She's going to be speaking to us today about pelvic and abdominal sensations when it comes to endometriosis. So maybe, Anna, you can tell us a little bit about how you got into this field and a little bit about what your practice is all about.
Absolutely. So I actually got into abdominal work in quite a roundabout way. I started off as a musician several years ago, working as a classical violinist. I started performing when I was very young, and suddenly in my teens, I noticed that when I got on stage, I was very anxious for the first time in my life as a teenager. And one of the things that I noticed was that when I went on stage, my diaphragm would contract, my body would get very tight, and whereas before I could create this beautiful big sound when I got nervous, everything came in and the sound was very small and weak. And so I was sent to a performer specialist to work with, almost kind of like a doctor for performers. And one of the things that she taught me was how to come into my body, how to notice how my body changed when I was under stress. And I think it was then for the first time I had somebody place their hands on my diaphragm, which is this part of your body right above your rib cage here. Mm-hmm. And I remember just having her hands on my diaphragm and being so overwhelmed by all the sensations that we hold here. Mm-hmm. And I would say it was one of the most transformative experiences of my life, mm-hmm. just experiencing how much tension I held there. So fast forward a few years later, I moved back to Canada and started working as a massage therapist. And I was very surprised by how few people have ever had that part of their body worked on before. And so I became quite obsessed, I guess you could say, with treating that area and learning as much as I could about working with the abdomen. And some of my first clients had endometriosis. And so through working with them and learning how to manage pain, my practice today is, I'd say the majority of my clients have endometriosis today. Mm-hmm. So,
yeah. And as far as your practice goes, treating a lot of abdominopelvic concerns generally,
yeah.
right? So my understanding yeah. is pain-related conditions as well as gastro-related issues like constipation and bloating.
Absolutely,
And those sorts of GI issues as well, right?
Yeah, so mm-hmm. I'd say today most of my treatments include some form of abdominal work, mm-hmm. which is quite peculiar in the RMT world.
Yes.
I think most massage therapists maybe treat the abdomen once or twice a year, you
yes,
know?
So I agree. Yeah.
On a daily basis to really have my hands on the abdomen for different reasons, I think it's taught me a lot.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And of course, you're trained to treat the whole body as well.
Absolutely.
So of course, whatever yeah. kind of comes mm-hmm. as a part of issues with yeah. pelvic and abdominal pain.
Yeah, so it's not about treating the abdomen mm-hmm. And ignoring everything else that's going on. It's about inviting treatment of that area in combination with the other parts of our body
right.
that need attention.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so let's talk a little bit more about how you can help women manage symptoms associated
yeah.
with endometriosis.
Yeah. So I see my role in helping women and trans men in managing endometriosis in three ways. The first way is in helping someone experience their body stress-free. And this sounds so basic, so simple, but it's actually one of the most profound, most challenging places to come to in our bodies.
Mm-hmm.
So a lot of people walk around all day long holding on so much. And so having the experience of coming into the body and letting go of some of that baseline of tension and stress, that in itself can be very, very powerful. And in order to come to this place, we need to feel safe, we need to feel seen, so it's really important to have that kind of supportive environment to come into that. From there, the second thing that I see my role as is in helping people tune in and listen to their bodies. So when we feel safe, when we feel relaxed, suddenly things come up in the body. And so I'm there to hold the space and to facilitate those conversations with the body. And then the third thing that I can offer is helping people release the tension that comes up when we are present. Mm-hmm. And sometimes just being there and being present is enough to release. It's pretty crazy. Time and time again, I see this. It's like, all I have to do is just be there and witness, and that's the work. It's done.
Right.
But sometimes we do need some extra support in that process. And then, so we have a wide range of techniques that we can use.
Mm-hmm. Sounds amazing. Yeah. Can you talk a little bit about some of the common areas of pain or discomfort that you see in your practice?
Yes. So I would say that the main area is maybe obviously the abdomen, specifically the lower abdomen. So you can think about the area just above the pubic bone, below the belly button, mm-hmm. and then to the sides. So around the hips is very common. Maybe an area that you're less familiar with would be the low back. Certainly around the sacrum is a really big place where mm-hmm. we see a lot of sensation and pain. Mm-hmm. And then other spots include kind of the sides of the hips, the inside of the legs, that's really big, especially kind of up into the groin. Mm-hmm. And then there can be all sorts of things as more of a compensation as well, so like neck, shoulders, legs.
Right. Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah. And what are the sorts of sensations that people will experience mm-hmm. when it comes to kind of something related to the abdominal area?
Yeah. I get to hear about so many sensations mm-hmm, all the time.
Sure.
I feel like I have a huge like catalog of sensations. So a huge range. I mean, on one end of the spectrum, you can have sensations like a burning, a pulling, a tingling even, sometimes a numbness, especially if there has been surgery or scar tissue. And then progressing to the other end of the spectrum, we have sensations like throbbing, aching, stabbing. So these are some of the mm-hmm. words that people use to describe sensations that they're experiencing. And then of course it's hard. We don't have the best vocabulary for describing what's going on in our bodies, right? So sometimes conversations look like hand gestures. People are like, oh, it just feels like there's this thing inside mm-hmm. my hip and I just want to like scoop it out, or you know, so there's a lot of different ways that we can check in with what's going on sensation wise. Mm-hmm. And sometimes it's a visual. It's like, oh, I feel this color or this shape. And so together we need to find like a common vocabulary to explore those sensations.
Right.
But I think it's really important work because it gives us clues as to what's going on in the body, right? Mm-hmm. And by having a regular practice of checking in, it also alerts us if things are changing, and that's key in preventative mm-hmm. care.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And I think with regards to sensations, especially related to pain, we're generally really good at forgetting what those sensations feel like.
Yeah.
Because we don't want to be in pain.
Absolutely.
And so
yeah.
I think people will have a hard time describing what sensations are,
yeah.
especially in retrospect, right?
Yeah. So. Or we, as you were saying, we don't want to feel like we are in pain, so mm-hmm. we don't want to listen, so we just push it down.
Right.
So to have some kind of regular practice, especially with support, where we come in and listen is pretty.
And can you tell us a little bit about some of the sensations with regards to the different types of tissues
mm-hmm.
In the body?
Yeah. So we could categorize sensations roughly as coming from two different places. We have connective tissue, which elicits sensations like pulling. Pulling and words associated with that often come up.
Mm-hmm.
So like a pulling, a tugging sensation, sometimes like a burning sensation close to the skin. As I was saying, if there's been a scar, sometimes like a numb kind of sensation.
Mm-hmm.
And then with muscle tissue, a lot of the sensations arise from trigger points. So trigger points being knots in muscles that have a predictable referral pattern in the body. And that often feels like there's one spot, but then you can't really trace where it's coming from because it's like moving down the body.
Mm-hmm.
And then, of course, if there's a spasm, it can be like a deep, achy, kind of throbbing pain.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And so connective tissue?
Yeah.
Can you talk a little bit more about that?
Yes. So, connective tissue, what we're generally referring to when we speak about connective tissue is fascia. And so what this tissue is, as the name suggests, it's tissue that connects structures. So you can think about like a packaging that surrounds the muscle, that surrounds the organ. But something that's really important to understand is that this packaging or this vessel, it's not isolated. So it's connected to everything around it, and it's not inert. So previously we thought that this structure was just there doing its thing. It couldn't respond. Now we know that it's incredibly responsive, especially to like sustained postural changes, right? Mm-hmm. So why this is relevant is because if you are continuously in pain and you're guarding and you're, you know, compressing through the abdomen, the connective tissue and the fascia will assume a tightened, shortened mm-hmm. position, which can then create more pulling, more pain, and then, you know, it's a cycle.
Yeah. So we've kind of talked a little bit about the difference between connective tissue and muscle.
Yes.
Restrictions with regards to sensations. Mm-hmm. The sensations different as well between the two, or can they present in a similar way?
Right. So they do present a little bit differently. As mm-hmm. I was saying before, connective tissue tends to present more with that kind of pulling, tugging, mm-hmm. associated more with postural changes, mm-hmm. right? And then, I mean, when we have deeper connective tissue restrictions, so when we get into like the scar tissue, it's a little bit different. Mm-hmm. But generally, when there's like a chain of connective tissue that's tight, and I mean, this could be a whole separate talk. There's so much to talk about there. Mm-hmm. If you're interested in learning a little bit more, there's a great book called Anatomy Trains mm-hmm. that talks about the different chains in the body and how they're connected. But yeah, so coming back to that, the connective tissue, it's more of those like pulling kinds of sensations, mm-hmm. whereas the muscle tissue is more of those kind of like aching, stabbing sensations, okay?
Okay.
And there are a few muscles in particular that I tend to look at a lot with people that have endometriosis because of their location or relationship to the uterus, they tend to get quite tight mm-hmm. and then create referral patterns.
Okay. Let's switch gears a little bit here. Maybe you can talk a little bit about some of the tools that you might recommend to women who are living with endometriosis so that they can manage their symptoms yeah. a little better.
Yeah. Well, I think having a practitioner you can work with is really key, and not just one practitioner, but finding your support, mm-hmm. your support team is really important.
Mm-hmm.
I think in terms of practitioners, whether it's an RMT or a physio or a chiropractor, whoever it is, finding someone that understands chronic pain is mm-hmm. really important.
Mm-hmm.
And I think we have this like cultural belief that more pain is more gain. Mm-hmm. And when it comes to endo, we want to stay clear of that.
Yes,
well, when it comes to any
100%.
Chronic pain, we want to stay clear of that.
Yes.
So that's really important.
Yes.
In terms of what you can do at home, having some practice of listening can be really helpful. In previous videos, we've talked about mindfulness-based practices. You know, mm-hmm. we've talked about different ways of checking in.
Mm-hmm.
Personally, I've always been drawn to like movement-based ways of tuning into my body. So whether that's yoga or dancing or, you know, some practice where you feel your body in movement and you can check in, that can be
mm-hmm.
great. And then something just as simple as hands on the belly. You can't go wrong. That's something I could suggest to anybody regardless of their medical history, right?
Right.
Hands on the belly, heat if it feels good, especially if there's some cramping, and just listening to the rhythm of the breath.
You hear a lot about castor oil and those sorts of packs that can be used on the abdomen. Can you
yeah.
talk a little bit about that?
Yeah. So I personally use castor oil in my practice with people, especially after surgery.
Mm-hmm.
So I'd say the two main areas that I would use that would be post-surgery. And if there is some bloating or cramping or like more digestive issues as well, because it can
right.
really help facilitate movement.
Okay.
You know, there's some interesting research in terms of castor oil and it benefits in helping facilitate movement, increase blood flow. But even besides the effects of castor oil, just having the heat can be really nice.
Right.
Because we place castor oil over the skin, and then there's a heating pack that goes on top of that. And then beyond the benefits of that, there's the benefit of just having the regular practice of self-care, right? Which can't be stressed enough. So.
Yeah. And heat is just so soothing.
It is really soothing. Yeah. But just coming back to post-surgery,
yes.
If there are really specific adhesions, I really love the castor oil because it helps kind of break that up, soften the tissue,
mm-hmm.
and then when people come back to me, it's a lot easier and I can kind of work
on it.
Yeah.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Is there any other specific knowledge that might be helpful for women who might find this sort of approach or treatment as far as abdominal massage?
Mm-hmm.
You know, if they find that overwhelming or if they find that that's just a little bit too much for them, that they can't approach that yet.
Yeah. So a lot of people will say to me or just look at me really blankly when I talk about checking in with the body because it's just really unapproachable,
yeah.
right?
Yeah.
So one thing that I find really helpful for people that might just not know what I mean by that is to check in with the anatomy, because the anatomy is super fascinating.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes just having a visual or maybe understanding from more of an anatomical perspective, what is going on in the body makes it almost like gives your body permission to feel what it's feeling.
Right.
Right? If you can understand how those structures are related, where
mm-hmm.
things sit. So I can give you an example of that.
Sure.
I will pull up my handy dandy pelvis over here.
So anybody see this pelvis?
Yes, pelvis. So what are we looking at here? We have the sacrum, which is this bone right back here, okay? And if I turn this pelvis around, and we are now looking from the front. This is the pubic bone right here. And if we tip it inwards, we can see our uterus hanging out here.
Mm-hmm.
And if I tip it forward even more, I don't know if we can see this here, but we have the rectum right in here.
Closer?
Yeah.
Yeah, there we go. There's the rectum right there.
Yeah. And then what you can start to see in this model here is the relationship between the sacrum, the rectum, and then our uterus here.
Mm-hmm.
And to each side, I don't know if there's a better picture. Can we see this over here?
Yeah.
So this is the uterus here. And to each side of the uterus, there's this big fold of tissue known as the broad ligament. And we have that here in our model. Hanging out right there.
Mm-hmm.
And that fold of tissue, it goes out towards the side of the pelvis, right? So some common places for endometriosis or lesions is behind the uterus, between the rectum and the uterus.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, especially kind of down low there. And then also common is between the bladder and the uterus. Also obviously the ovaries on either side here.
Mm-hmm.
And so what you can begin to see is that if there's an area of restriction, so if that tissue is adhered to one another, it's not just going to affect that area. It's going to affect everything else around it.
Right.
So if we have a pulling on one side,
mm-hmm.
that tension, that restriction is going to transfer into potentially the sacrum,
mm-hmm.
into the muscles around it.
Mm-hmm.
And
also, you know, around all of these organs, is fascia.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So we have all these different layers of fascia, and I sometimes explain it to my clients as saran wrap, because if you tug one side of saran wrap,
yeah.
it's going to tug to the other side.
Yeah.
So definitely something happening on one side can affect the other side.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And I mean, the uterus itself and the ovaries and the fallopian tubes, they're incredibly mobile structures,
mm-hmm.
or they
mm-hmm.
ideally are quite mobile. And so if you've ever had a vaginal ultrasound, for example, you will see that your uterus can be in a few different positions depending on what time of the cycle it is, on different factors.
Mm-hmm.
But what we see happening in a condition like endometriosis is it's not moving quite
right.
as much.
Yeah.
And so it's less about where the uterus is sitting and more about does it have the ability to move within its natural range.
Right. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Makes sense.
So.
Any other techniques techniques or anything else about this mm-hmm. area you'd like to share with clients or that you find are effective with regards to treatment?
Yeah. One area that I feel is really overlooked is probably the adductors. Mm-hmm. So for those that don't know, I'm just gonna see if we can see over here.
I'm just gonna shift it over a bit.
So here is the adductors. They run on the inside of the leg. So you can think from like the inside of your knee right up into the groin area here. And they are a group of muscles that that draw the leg inwards towards the midline, if you want to think about it that way. Mm-hmm. And so there are trigger points, especially in the upper fibers of the muscle, so closer towards the groin, that can refer up into the pelvic floor.
Okay.
And so what I see with people is that sometimes they will have like persistent pelvic pain, groin pain, even sort of like pelvic floor pain that gets better with different treatments, but mm-hmm. never quite goes away until the adductors are looked at.
Right.
And I mean, it's hard to say where it came from. I think that often people with endometriosis have gone through a lot of treatments. And there's a lot of, like, there's just a lot of, like, fear and guarding.
Holding.
And, like, even just thinking about, like, I can just feel my legs, like, drawing inward, right? And so it makes sense to me that tension would build up there.
Mm-hmm.
So that's one area that I think it's overlooked and that can be really helpful. The other area that I would say is probably the sacrum.
Right.
Just again, because of its relationship to the uterus, I find that work around the sacrum or to the muscles in the deep glutes there can be very helpful. And then, I don't know if this one's as overlooked. I think that it's has a lot more recognition now, would be the psoas muscle and the QL muscle,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
So those guys are over here. I don't know if we can see that there, but we can think of them as these like deep stabilizing pelvic muscles, right? So we have the psoas in the front and the QL in the back, but in reality they're very close to one another. And the psoas muscle, it flexes the hip inward, and the QL does the opposite, it extends the low back. And they are on both sides of the spine and go out into the hips. So there are these big stabilizing muscles for the pelvis. And the referral pattern for especially for the psoas is through to the low back and then the side of the hip and kind of going down the groin a little bit.
Okay.
And I find that, especially when the lower attachments are tight, women often say to me, it's like I just want to scoop out my hips. Like it's this kind of like sensation of wanting to like just like open up from the inside.
Right.
And definitely it's an area that I work on almost with everybody, I would say.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So. And of course a lot of these muscles, and actually most of them, are attaching to the pelvis, passing through the pelvis.
Yes.
And so if that doesn't, mm-hmm. it's not super surprising that they can become involved,
mm-hmm.
right?
Yeah.
All right. Was there anything else that you wanted to add? We talked a lot about a lot of different things there. I think that's super helpful.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of different layers through the organs, through the fascia, through all mm-hmm. the muscles, throughout the abdomen and the pelvis.
Mm-hmm.
So I think what we can do now is maybe close by doing a pelvic scan.
Yeah, absolutely.
So everyone out there, I'm going to leave you with Anna. She's going to lead you through, I guess, a meditation of the abdominal pelvic area.
Yeah, so what I was thinking is just to take you through a scan of the pelvis. If you're familiar with more of like a full body scan, it is a way to check into the body and relax tension in the body. But what we're gonna do today is just focus on the pelvis. And what I'm gonna try to do is provide some specific pelvic anatomy as we go through it as well for those mm-hmm. that maybe respond better to visualization. But I'm going to suggest a few things as I go along, and if something doesn't feel right for you, just ignore it and take what suits you.
Great.
Okay.
So I'm going to remove myself from the screen again. I already have been kind of through the talk.
Okay.
We're going to just
Okay.
Let me put you right in the center there. Is that good?
Yes. I'm just going to take a moment here to ground myself so I'm a little bit Okay.
All right.
That's good. And so after we are done here, we're gonna just turn off this video. So we will be closing here. If you are at home and just want to take a moment to dim the lights or find yourself in a seated position, I really like to lie down on the floor and place a couple pillows under the knees so that I have some support for my low back. So you can take a moment to do that. And then we're just going to start here by taking a few deep breaths into our lower abdomen. And there's no right or wrong way to breathe here, but just feeling what your breath is doing in this moment. And I invite you, if it feels right, to place your hands over the lower abdomen. So you can think about placing them below the belly button and above the pubic bone. And for those that might not be familiar, that the pubic bone is located below the belly button. So if you walk your hands down from the belly button, it is the first and only bone and hard surface that you will feel. And this is a really important connection point for lots of connective tissue, lots of muscle. And so if you can think about taking a deep breath into the pubic bone, it has the impact of releasing lots of different structures. So let's just take a deep breath into the pubic bone here. And if your hands are resting above the pubic bone here, your hands are over the uterus and over the bladder. And the uterus, the top of the uterus, the fundus of the uterus, sits about a third of the way between the pubic bone and belly button, just in case you want to visualize that. And notice any sensations you might feel here. Maybe there's a sense of pressure, maybe there's a tingling, maybe there's some pain today. We're just here to notice that. Okay. And as we move our hands slightly over to the sides now, so you can think lower abdomen still, but just slightly to each side, our hands are now over the area of the ovaries. And this can be a place of a lot of tenderness for some people, so just be gentle with yourself. And just noticing any sensations. Maybe we'll just check in with the left side first and take a deep breath. And moving our hands to the right side. Does that side feel different? Maybe it doesn't. Maybe you don't notice anything. That's okay as well. Taking a deep breath here. And while we have our hands to either side over the ovaries, it's worth mentioning that the psoas muscle is also in this area. So you could imagine it running from your belly button outwards like a triangle towards the hips. Just sending your awareness, noticing any tension running from that area. Okay. And now, if you're lying on your back, this is a really good time to feel the connection of your low back with the floor. If you're seated, you can just notice right at the base of your spine, your sacrum. And we're just going to take a deep breath into the sacrum. This can be an area of a lot of tension. So again, just be gentle with yourself, noticing any areas of sensation through the low back. And so if we just want to visualize for a moment the sacrum and then the uterus, which sits on the sacrum, and there are these wonderful ligaments that attach the uterus to the sacrum. And so when the sacrum gets tight on one side, that can transfer into the uterus. let's just take a moment to visualize that and breathe into the back of the sacrum here. And next, let's just bring our awareness to the inside of the legs. If you're seated, you could place your hands on the insides of your knees. If you're lying on your back, maybe you could just open your legs just slightly so you can feel the insides a little bit more. And we're just noticing here, how does that feel? Does it feel like there's any vulnerability or tension or desire to kind of draw in towards the center? Does it feel comfortable to have your legs there? As you bring your awareness a little bit closer towards the pelvis, does it feel like there's any tenderness? And then let's just check in with the left side and take a deep breath there. And shift over to the right. Okay. And now I'm just gonna put aside all the anatomy, and we're just gonna come back to the base, to the pelvis. We're gonna visualize a bowl. And with your breath or your awareness, or if you like, you could send a color into that, we are just going to do a sweep around the pelvic bowl. And notice if there are any areas that feel like they need a little bit of attention, or that if they have anything to say. So starting at the left side of this pelvic basin, just notice what's going on there today. Is there a shape that comes to mind, a color, a sensation? Okay. And we're not here to change it. We're just here to listen to it. Okay. And coming towards the center in the front of this basin. And then working our way towards that right side. And lastly, let's bring our awareness to the back of this pelvic bowl. So for some people, this can be a more challenging place to feel. If it helps you, you could place your hand on your low back, or you could take a really deliberate breath into your low back, or you could just accept that maybe you're not feeling anything there if it's challenging. Okay. And if you're practicing this at home, this is a place where you could stop and make a few passes of the pelvic bowl or basin, just observing any sensations that come up and observing for yourself if it changes after a few sweeps. And we are just going to close here. We're going to end where we started by bringing our hands over the lower abdomen as a way of closing. And we're going to take a few deep breaths here. Thank you. And this, for some people, might be a place where they want to pick up a pen and paper and just jot down some things that they noticed, but it's not necessary. This can be a really nice practice in the morning. It can be a really nice practice at the end of the day. So just check in to see how maybe the things that you did today impacted your body. All right. Thank you very much for joining us today.